Begin. OIKOessence welcomes you to the webinar series Spectrum of Conservation. Through this webinar series, we are trying to invite all researchers and expertise to share their knowledge with us, the common people, so that the message of conservation can spread to a larger extent. A little about OIKOessence. We have been conducting environment education activities for past almost 5 years now. These activities include workshops, seminars, nature trails, nature camps. Some people always ask us, what do you mean by OIKOessence? Basically, OIKOessence, this oikos is derived, is a Greek word for home. And we have taken that oiko from oikos and we have added an essence to it, and that's how it has become OIKOessence. Throughout this session, as I said, we will be following few rules. That are, one is we have to keep our videos off, microphone on mute mode. In case you have any questions, any doubts, you can put them into the chat box. I will gather all your questions and I'll ask them at the end of our session. Okay. Now about our today's speaker, Dr. Shreya Bhanap. She is designated partner of OIKOessence EduTours LLP. She has completed her PhD in ethnobotany, conservation strategy of some ethnobotanical plants used by Warli tribe in Thane district of Maharashtra. She has published over 30 articles that includes her research papers as well as popular articles. One of her articles has also been published in Kumar Vishwakosh, which is published by Homi Bhabha Center for Science, Mumbai. She has more than 15 years of experience in the field of environment education. And she has also contributed to a book of Trees of Shivaji Park. Well, that was a very little presentation of her massive work. It's over to you, Dr. Shreya. You may start. Thank you.
Thank you, Gauri. So our today's topic for the webinar is, as you have seen in the posters, Fruits from Forest to Farms. I think fruits are considered Homo sapiens' oldest food. That is, whenever Homo sapiens, the older form of the Homo sapiens, they start living on the earth, fruits are the one which are edible for them. Of course, it was a great research that they carried out, that which are edible fruit, which are non-edible fruit, which are poisonous one, and what to eat and what not to eat. So today's topic is related with
Rani. Rani.
As I said, fruits as a food. 2.3 million to 1.2 million years ago, the species of human being which was existing on the earth was a nutcracker man. The shapes of the teeth and the jawline was designed according to the food, and that's why it has a very large jaw with two prominent teeth, so that they can eat the hard food, whatever the hard nutty fruits are there, they can easily break them down and they can have it as a food. And this was the very first recorded thing, which is, that means the fruits were edible by the oldest human being, oldest Homo sapiens, which was present on the earth. After that, when people start eating fruit, the Homo sapiens, which were the oldest one, they start eating fruit. Slowly, evolution of food occurs. In the Bronze Age, the research shows that very first domestication of the cereals and grains. See, the fruits came later, but the earlier domestication was of cereals and grains, mostly rice, wheat, maize, and then came the fruits. So very first the cereals and grains were domesticated and the fruits were domesticated. but that was again during the Bronze Age, that is 3000 to 1200 BC, and that is the first recorded reference for the fruits as a food, and that is not only from the wild but also from the palms. It may not be in the form of orchards. Many trees may not be planted at the same place, but they started planting trees for their own. It is not just like they have collected from the wild, gathered it from the wild, and they are eating it. It's not like that. They have again started sowing those seeds and planting that particular plant for themselves. So that is the very earlier domestication of the fruit plants. Similar things happens with the grains, as well as with the cereals, as well as with the whatever meat and chicken and everything. So very early reference is from the Bronze Age human beings. So which fruits were domesticated first? It is but natural that the fruits which are sweet in taste, good in pulp quantity, are earlier they were domesticated, or they were edible. The human beings eating them was in much more quantity than the hard or stony or nutty fruits. So dates, then the figs, grapes, olives, these are the fruits which are soft in pulp, sweeter than other fruits, and not so hard or nutty, were favorite for the Bronze Age human beings. So the very first domestication of wild fruit is recorded with the dates, with the figs, with the grapes, or with the olives. And these records are always checked with the help of either fossil records or with the help of cultural and religious writings or the poems, or with the help of pictures, the paintings which were done in those period of time. So with the help of all these things, the domestication of the wild fruit is studied. How these domesticated fruits, they slowly start converting them into the palms. Very first thing we must say that only indigenous species were first domesticated. See, exotic varieties are far away for them. So we are talking about the 3000 BC period, when the traveling and the other facilities were not so easy for them. So whatever the indigenous species, whatever the species present in that area, they were first get domesticated. And selection of wild genotype followed by the interprocess between the elites and the wild clones. That means if some wild species, say banana, if it is present in the wild and then they have started cultivating them near their habitats, wherever they have settlements, near their settlements, it might possible that because of the natural process or because of the natural parthenocarpy in the banana, the banana which is near to the settlement is more sweeter than the banana which is present in the wild. And that's why the banana which is near to their settlement, they start again and again cultivating the same banana. So because of the natural selection, this is with the help of natural selection, very slowly human being started domesticating the fruits. It's not a very fast process. See, thousands of years were there. They need to select the fruit, they need to select the proper crosses, they need to select the elite fruit for that, elite seeds for that, and then the R&D goes on, and nowadays the future, today's fruits are there. Now why there is a need for such selection of genotypes? See, I think everyone knows that banana, which is present in the wild, so it is mostly with the seeds, whether it's an insetive species or whether it's a musa species. Both the species are seeded. You can see here, it's a seeded species, and it's very difficult to eat such type of seeded fruit. It will not give you very soft taste to the, it's not palatable also. So that's why when the parthenocarpy happens, or if the natural selection happens, they need to remove these seeds, and this took lot many years. And slowly, with the help of natural selection and with the help of selection with the good varieties whichever they found in different areas of their settlement. Then they used to cross them, and then slowly with the help of that, we today's banana, which is a seedless variety, is there. Same thing happens with the watermelon, same thing happens with the figs or many other species which we eat today as a very, you know, palatable fruits, and we like their taste, unka rang acha hota hai, unka sweetness jyada acha hota hai. So this is because of the research carried out by the our ancestral on our fruit varieties. So indigenous wild fruits were converted into palms with the help of all these techniques and with a very slow pace. Majority of the fruits are converted into palms only in 19th and 20th century. See, hardly 200 to 300 years back, if you consider the history of Homo sapiens, the time period the Homo sapiens are existing on the earth, hardly 200 to 300 year back, we are able to convert these wild varieties into the domesticated palm varieties, and which are little more palatable and little more sweeter in taste or good in color or easy to grow, and shelf life is increased. So on these basic things, basically the fruits were studied, and then they were converted into the slowly into domestication and then into the farm process. So if you consider, in the world almost 2000 species are edible as fruits. In case of plant genera, almost 2000 species are edible. It includes all type of fruit. It may be stony fruit, it may be berries, it may be pods, it may be anything, maybe climber, it may be shrub, it may be a mangrove species, anything, but 2000 species. And if you consider India, 600 varieties are edible as a fruit. This includes wild varieties which are directly collected and eaten, and the domesticated variety which are present in the farm. It's like, it may include an Alfonso mango, which is nowadays, you know, mango orchards are present, or it may be some wild mango, rival or the badami mango, which is present directly in the wild areas. So almost 600 species are edible as a fruit, and this is the fruit which is directly, you know, eaten as a fruit. It is not like it is some other techniques are carried out. No, it's not like that. Directly edible fruits are 600 number of species. The world's most favorite fruit, you can see here, is banana. It is world's most favorite fruit. This list gives you the world's most favorite fruits. So here first stands the banana. I think banana is a very old fruit which is first domesticated also in India. It is also first domesticated. Even a small baby, for a small baby also, we can give the first food of the baby is banana powder. So maybe because of that, banana is a first most favorite fruit in the world. Some of the very common and very popular, if you consider wild fruits in India, then there is a bale, there is a Indian date palm, or the we called it at khajur, Indian khajur jo hota hai wo. Then it is bakul, or the Mimosops ilingi fruits.
Shreya?
Yes.
Hello, Shreya.
Yes.
Your voice is lagging. So, yeah, you can speak a little slowly.
Yeah, we do. It may be because of the internet.
Possible.
Yeah. So, it may be a Mimosops ilingi or the bulletwood tree, ice apple or the tadgolas. Meswak fruit, this is a mangrove species. So meswak fruits, these berries are edible. They have little alcohol content as well. Then elephant apple, this fruit is edible. And we have Mainesa, Penguria spinosa. Alive is the Marathi name for this fruit. This is, when ripe, it is edible. Tamarindus, Imli, or the tamarind species. wild strawberries. These are the some of the very popular and easily available fruits in the wild parts of the India, all over India. So these fruits, as I said, they are never domesticated, or they are never like converted into a big palms or in orchards. But still, whenever the season is there, if it's an annual plant, then whenever the season is there, they are collected and either sell or eaten by them for their own thing. Now, which are the very common fruits, or which are the most popular fruits domesticated in India or converted into farmyards in India? And again, they are indigenous species, that is, their presence in the wild, in the Indian subcontinental region, is already there. So, very first species is a Punica granatum, or the Anardana, Dalimba. The Marathi name of this fruit is Dalimba, or the Anardana. The records shows that it is cultivated almost from 5,000 years ago. See, these fruits, variety of these fruits are already present in the wild. But wild fruit may not be very soft in seeds, or may not be, the color of rind may not be good, might not be such a red, or any other things, many other things are there. So slowly, with the help of natural hybridization or the natural crosses, or with the cross with some or other fruits, they are converted, whatever the palate we like, the today's modern human likes, and then they are farmed. Then there the orchards are present. So the cultivation of such very sweet and palatable Punica started almost 5,000 years ago in India. When I say in India, it means the Asian flora, because 5,000 years ago, there was no boundary what we have for today's India. The boundaries were different. So it's a Indian area, it's a continent area, the whole area. So the today's wild variety of the Punica are still present in northern India from the base of Himalaya. We have wild species of Punica are present, mostly in Darlaghat. Darlaghat is a very small village from Solan. It's hardly 50 kilometers from Solan Valley. And this is a place where majority of the wild pomegranate shrubs are still present. And again, those fruits are edible and they are collected for the sale. So Darlaghat is a place from where the majority of our wild, what you can say, Punica, they are ready for the sales. So again, this crosses for the Punica particularly happens very first for the soft seeds, again for the less acids which is present in the seeds, they are more acidic for the less acids, and attractive color of the ring. If you see a wild Punica granatum fruit, wild Anardana fruit, the rind is orangish in color. It's not like this pink color is not there. Rind is orangish in color, and it looks very dull. It doesn't look attractive. So for those reasons, these crosses were there. Popular variety for today's Punica are Ganesh, Arakta, Phule Bhagwa, and Phule Bhagwa is a variety which is exported also. Even Arakta is exported, and Phule Bhagwa is the variety which they have crossed with the Russian variety of the Punica fruit. So Russian variety of Punica was grafted on the Indian plant, and the fruits, the plant which bears the fruit, and that variety was named by the Horticulture Society as the Phule Bhagwa variety. And today, even all these three varieties are exported out. Mostly we export to UAE or the Netherlands. In this area, it is exported. India is fourth in position which exports Anardana to the world. It is majorly cultivated in Maharashtra, Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh, Gujarat, and Tamil Nadu. Maharashtra also, Solapur and Sangli, the dried or arid region of the Maharashtra, that is where the Punica orchards are present. In mythology also, if you consider Hindu mythology, if you study Hindu mythology, it symbolizes prosperity and the fertility. It's a many-seeded fruit, many seeds fruit. The fruit is single, but it has many seeds into it. So it symbolizes the prosperity and the fertility. In case of India, on many varieties of foods and for the other material also, GI tagging is done. That is, the geographical tagging is done. For the Punica species, Solapur is the area. The Punica, which are harvested from the Solapur area, they are GI tagged and are very easy for the export. So in Punica from the Solapur area are very good in taste, good in color. The size of the fruit is really very heavy, and that's why they are GI tagged and easy for harvest. Then the very common fruit, I will say, of the world is the Musa paradisiana, that is the banana, kima keli mantu apan dela, kela Hindi me. So the record shows that its cultivation started almost 10,000 years ago in the Indian region, and it is said to be first plant to be cultivated, first plant to be converted into an orchard was the banana. For banana, actually, it's very easy because natural hybridization is very fast. Parthenocarpic fruit is there, so natural hybridization is very fast in case of banana. And that's why the domestication is also very easy in case of banana. The wild varieties of banana, that is Musa, Musa serenia, are still present in Nagaland and Assam, in the forest of Nagaland and Assam. When I say wild varieties, they are not now. They are very much restricted to the core forest patches of these areas. See, because of the urbanization and other problems, the forest cover is decreasing. And so it is very hard to find the original species, original species of these kind of plants. So now their number is decreasing and the presence is in the remote corners of the forest. So the species are still present in Nagaland and Assam. And now bananas are cultivated throughout India. It's a very common crop and very, I will say, cash crop for major parts of India. The varieties which are cultivated are Robusta, Mothon, Puan, Mendran, Virupakshi and Sirumalai, out of which the Sirumalai and Virupakshi are the hill bananas which have got the GI tags. These varieties are crossed for the seedless variety and the sweeter pulp and the shelf life. See, shelf life for banana is very important factor for the crosses because it has hardly any shelf life. So for that reason, they are crosses and seedless variety and the sweeter, more and more sweeter pulp. Presence of banana in our mythological text is always there. There is a very famous story in Mahabharata which shows that banana was present from those period of time. The banana is there. See, the plant is there and it is very easily cited, and that's why then they are recorded into the stories. This is one of the methods why the stories are important to study the ethnobotany. So the story in Mahabharata shows that the plant was present in good number in that particular period of time. Then our very own apple. It is always now, whenever you visit the market, not during the lockdown, of course, but now you can slowly start visiting the market with all the safety. And we will see majority of the apples which are sold in markets, they have a tag, you know, the Washington apple or something other. But the apple, even our wild areas, which are there in Himachal Pradesh, they have wild varieties of apple. We have almost 12 indigenous species of apples, which are present in the Himachal Pradesh and the foothills of the Himalaya. And almost 4,000, from the 4,000 BC, we have started cultivating apples. Many of the visitors, the foreign visitors, Huan Sang and others, who have visited India during those period, they have written that they have seen apple fruits, apple orchards in the path or while going to from one area to other area, they have seen the apples. So from that period, we are cultivating apples. The apples which are the today's apple fruit, the today's apple fruit is because of the trade along the Silk Road. See, what used to happen, we have apples in our area and even in China. So when people used to eat it, or the domesticated horses or other animals, they used to eat it, the seeds, they were thrown out in some or other area and the trees used to grow there. So from those trees and the trees which are present in a wild area of the Indian region, when they were processed, then good varieties of apples were there. And whichever plant is of good variety, more sweeter pulp, or maybe the pulp is more smooth in nature, or maybe the rind or the outer cover is very thin, or maybe the color is attractive, maybe the size of the fruit is bigger than the wild one. So on these categories, that particular plant, then they select those plants. They used to have seeds, collect seeds from those plants, and again planted into the area near their settlement. So with the help of Buddhist and Hindu monks, actually the apple travel from Indian and Chinese region to the whole of the world, and from there actually it got developed, and the taste, the whatever the taste, today's apple taste is there, the ochre is, that credit goes to the Indian and Buddhist monks. The today's popular varieties for apple are the Royal Delicious, or Lal Amri, Golden Delicious, Suneheri, Priscilla. All these varieties, again, we can export. We export apples to the rest of the world. India stands fifth to export apples to the world. And in mythology also, it is a forbidden fruit. In Indian mythology as well as in Christian mythology, apple is considered as a forbidden fruit. I think everyone knows the story of Adam and Eve. They were not supposed to eat the apple fruit, but then they ate it, and the rest of the story is there. So that's why it is a forbidden fruit. Our next fruit is very popular in the wild area. Whenever we go out, we try and search for this particular fruit. Ziziphus mauritiana, or the Indian jujube, or the bear, jo aapko school ke bahar bhi mil jate hai, wo wale bear. This is the fruit which India has given to the world, the bear, that was first ever cultivated fruit in India. Today also we are the one of the largest exporter of the bear to the rest of the world. So India, from the wild also we collect bear, that is Indian jujube, and even we have plantations for the Ziziphus plants in many areas of Haryana, Punjab, Uttar Pradesh, Gujarat, Rajasthan, Maharashtra. So where the bear plantation, jujube plantation is also there, and also it is collected from wild and sold. So with both the techniques, bear is collected for the human consumption. Many of the species are sun-dried also for the bear. So the very first fruit which is cultivated in India was bear. We have almost 125 wild varieties throughout India. Whenever you roam in the forest, whenever you visit the jungle, you will find at least 3 to 4 species of Ziziphus over there. All the species yield edible fruits. The taste, the size, the rind color, that may differ, but all the species are with the edible fruits. You can feast on them in the forest. Whenever you are there in the forest, you can really feast on the bear and the karwanda, the chrysanthemum plant. So if you are in the season, your lunch is ready in the forest. So cultivation is already there. The varieties which are popular and which we are exporting are the Gola, Umran, Banarasi, Karka, Mundia, Mehrun, and Parbani. See, all these varieties are developed by the Krishi Vidyapits which are present throughout India. the agriculture institutes which are present throughout India. So this kind of work is always going on. Behind the curtain, the work is always going on. Only thing is that they are not much popular in the public. Like the genetic work, they are not much popular in the public. And that's why this all this beautiful variety, the tasty variety, the credit goes to the Krishi centers, Krishi Vidyapeeth universities of the which are present throughout India and their research mainly. The most I think popular variety nowadays, I think from last 5 to 6 years, I will say the most popular variety is the apple bear. The bear which has a very good in size, green in color, almost sweeter in taste. But that is actually a cross between a Thailand variety of green apple, that is the Malus species, and the Indian Zuzubi, that is the Zizipus species. But again, this is with the natural selection, not natural crosses. It's not any nothing genetically modified into these varieties. These are not GM crops, genetically mutant crops. Nahi hai ye. With the help of natural cross between the green apple and the Zuzupa species, the whatever the fruits bear by that particular plant were called as the green apple bear. And then they are studied, and then they are again given to the farmers for the mass cultivation. And now mostly this Rajasthan and in Maharashtra, mostly we can see the plantations of the apple bear, which is there, and it's available in the market also. We export these bears, apple bears also. In the mythology, if you study bear, then the famous story in the Ramayana, the Shabri aur Ram ki jo story hai, Shabri ne apne jhoote bear Ram ko khilaye the. So there the presence of Zizipus mauritiana in the history is there. So bear, which is one of the common and often, you know, less palatable fruit, it is considered, but it's not, it's very tasty, and you can check it out. Then again, very important fruit, and what you can say, very highly, you can say the from the Indian origin, indigenous fruit, is the Ficus carica, or the जिसको हम लोग कॉमन फिग बोलते हैं, या फिर अंजीर जिसको बोलते हैं, कॉमन फिग या फिर अंजीर. ऑल द फाइकस स्पीशीज आर इंडिजिनस टू इंडिया. वी हैव ऑलमोस्ट 22 स्पीशीज ऑफ फाइकस, एंड ऑल ऑफ देम आर ऑफ ग्रेट इम्पोर्टेंस, नॉट ओनली टू द फॉरेस्ट. आई मीन फॉरेस्ट में तो है ही, बट स्टिल देयर यू कैन सी देयर पेंटिंग्स, यू कैन सी देयर राइटिंग अबाउट देम, द राइटिंग्स अबाउट देम इन अवर कल्चर, इन अवर हिस्ट्री. So everywhere the importance of ficus species is stated. And today also, even for the plantation purpose, if the ficus species are there, then a single ficus plant can be a whole ecosystem. So one of the species, Ficus carica, or the common fig, or the anjeer, which is most you know, popular for as an edible purpose. Even we eat ficus, rest of the ficus species like guler हम लोग खाते हैं, लेकिन उससे भी ज़्यादा अच्छी sweetness में and the size of the fruit is the ficus carica. Again ficus carica, this species you can see in the forested area in throughout India, and this is the plant which is domesticated very early by humans. Again because it is very easy for the domestication, natural selection process is easy in case of these plants. Nowadays it is cultivated in Gujarat, Maharashtra, even Uttar Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, where you can see the anjeer orchids. Anjeer ke jaise mango orchids hote hai, you will find the anjeer orchids over there, where they plant this fruit, take care, harvest them, even exports some of the fruits, some of the varieties are exported. So varieties which are popular are Puna, Dinkar, and Daulatabad. Out of which Purandar fig from the Pune area, it is GI tag. The fruit is the rind is reddish in color and very sweet in taste, and that's why they are GI tag for the Purandar fig. Again, these are crossed. The crosses were made and the domestication process happened because for the sweet pulp and easy pollination and the shape and size of the fruit. In mythology, all the ficus plants, they are the sacred. They have a sacred value. Religious importance is there. Important part of the paintings, culture, even the stones in the stone paintings also, the ficus species. The paintings are there about the ficus species. You can relate those species with the ficus species. The what I will say, most common fruit is the mango. I think mango is the fruit. These trees, mango trees, see, I'm not talking only about the Alfonso mango, but the mango, Mangifera indica trees, are always there in any part of the forest, in any part of the India. There, it's always there in the forested area, in any part of the India, not the higher altitudes in Himalaya, but from the lower altitudes up to the Kanyakumari. So everywhere you will find these Mangifera indica trees, and with lot of varieties. See, we have almost 1200 plus varieties of Mangifera indica only in India. Only in India we have it. And mango is again the fruit which is given by Indian subcontinent region to the world. So its origin, the first domesticated origin, is Indo-Burman Malayan region, northeast India and the Burma area. From there, the species was selected and then multiplied and given for the rest of the people for the domestication purpose. So from that original, from that area, the today's mango fruit are coming. In India, the cultivation was almost from the, since 4,000 years ago. Again, many of our visitors, foreign visitors, they have recorded in their writings that they have seen mango trees along the roadside or along the river along with the river banks and all. So they are mostly nowadays they are cultivated almost in each and every state of India, including Andaman Nicobar. As I said, those are islands, but even they have their own specific varieties which are very sweet in taste. So even they are cultivated over there. The most popular varieties, see, for the today's cultivation also, we have almost 90 plus varieties which are in cultivation. But the most popular one, of course, the Alfonso, and the Bombay is there, Himsagar is there, Suvarnarekha, Dashehra Aam, Neelam Aam, Chausa, Kishanbhog, Banangpalli. So these are the mangoes which are most popular for the cultivation purpose, out of which Baganpalli, Fazli, Neelam, Chausa are exported along with the Alfonso mango, Hapus, jo jata hai, in almost each and every corner of the world, Indian Alfonso are exported. That is the most popular fruit for the export purpose. And it is exported from various regions of the, mostly through Maharashtra, but again from the other regions also. So with the Alfonso variety, even the Baganpalli variety, Neelam, Chausa variety, Fazli variety, these are also exported. Some of the varieties like Himsagar or Suvarnarekha, mostly they are exported for the canning purpose, canning and juice purpose. See, in India, we are very favorite. Fruit itself is a favorite food for the Indians. But in some part of the world, juice is preferred, or the canning industry, that the fruit, the pulp is canned and then it is considered as an edible. So these varieties are exported for that purpose. But here in India, we just, you know, ek aam le liya aur khana start kar diya. So that was the Indian mythology like that. So again, the crosses, since long time there is study is going on with the mangoes, and the crosses were for the sweet pulp, small seed, jo andar ki seed hoti hai wo thoda small rahe aur pulp jyada rahe uske liye, attractive color, the hapus ka jo yellow color hai, ya fir नीलम का जो ब्लूइश टिंच वाला कलर है, फॉर दैट कलर दी क्रॉसेस वेर देयर. एंड इंडिया इज द फर्स्ट अमंग द वर्ल्ड्स मैंगो प्रोडक्शन. एज आई टोल्ड यू इट इज एक्सपोर्टेड ऑलमोस्ट ईच एंड एवरी कॉर्नर ऑफ द वर्ल्ड. सो दैट्स व्हाई इन मैथोलॉजी इट इज अ सैक्रेड ट्री, कंसिडर एज अ सैक्रेड ट्री. इट्स ऑलवेज देयर इन आर्ट कल्चर, in religious, wherever the religious functions are there, we always hang a mango twig or the leaves, mango leaves hang karke rakhte hain. So that's why in art and culture it is always used. And GI tagging is done for the Dashahari mango, which is the variety of Uttar Pradesh. It is said that actually majority of these mangoes are evolved from the mangoes which are present in a Lakh Bagh. See, the king Babur, the Mughal king Babur, he planted almost 1 lakh mango trees along the Darbhanga river, along the belt. Darbhanga river ka jo river bank hai wahan pe Mughal king Babur ne almost 1 lakh mango trees lagaye. And from that was like a gene bank. Now that Lakh Bagh, still that not all 1 lakh trees are present, but stresses are there. So from that gene bank, whatever comes out, whatever the better variety of fruits were there, they are collected and now they are spread for the cultivation. Of course, the Alfonso is a completely different story. I think everyone knows that Alfonso is the variety which is brought by the Portuguese. See, Portuguese, they brought the Alfonso mango twig. वहाँ पे जो अल्फांसो है पुर्तगाल में, दैट मैंगो ट्विग वाज बॉर्न एंड दैट वाज ग्राफ्टेड ऑन द वाइल्ड वैरायटी इन द कोकन रीजन. सो दैट ग्राफ्ट ऑन द वाइल्ड वैरायटी, द फ्रूट्स वेर वेरी स्वीट इन टेस्ट, वेरी जूसी, द कलर वाज नाइस, शेल्फ लाइफ वाज गुड एंड देन दे बिकेम द अल्फांसो, द किंग ऑफ द फ्रूट दैट इज नोन एज अल्फांसो. एंड दैट all these things in that fruit which are not there in Portugal also, that is said to be because of the climatic conditions of the Kokan region, the soil, the air, the other temperature, moisture, these are the factors. So because of that, today's Alfonso, which is the king of the fruit, is in the that particular belt of the Kokan or that particular belt of the Maharashtra region. So this Mangifera indica, I think the most work, the most research work is carried out on this particular fruit, and I think that's why it is the king of the fruit. And then comes the coconut. Actually, coconut in India, mostly it is used in the recipe or the culinary work which is there, but actually this is a fruit. If you speak botanically, then this the coconut what we eat is a fruit of that particular palm tree. So Coccus nucifera is a monocot, which is a palm from the palm family, and the coconut which are edible is the fruit of that particular tree. Again, there are chances that the origin of the coconut is from the Indian Ocean basin, the towards the Kerala side, the ocean is there. See, it has a very hard covering, so it can float on the water. All these coconut plantations, you can see, they are along the coastal belt of India. So in the wild, wherever these coconuts were present, so Indian varieties and Pacific variety, it might possible that the cross between them gives out today's Coccus nucifera, gives birth to the today's Coccus nucifera plants. So this again, it is originated from Indian oceans, so Indian subcontinental area, and nowadays it is cultivated in Kerala, Karnataka, mostly through the coastal belt of the India. The recorded cultivation of the coccus, that is coconut, is almost 3000 year ago, and mostly the variety, the process or the selection was on the basis of yield for the fruit. Many fruits, the plant which can bear many fruits, oil yield, coconut oil is extracted, so for that oil yield, cobra which is dried and exported in rest of the world, for that cobra quality desiccated coconut for which is exported. Some of the varieties are actually planted only for the copra region, copra purpose, and then that copra is desiccated coconut convert karke export kiya jata hai. So mostly for these things the coconut are processes are done on that region area. So most popular varieties are Kappadam, then the Laguna variety, Sun Raman, Malayan, Dwarf, then Manjipod, Pratap, Manoli, and the variety which are nowadays you will observe in many of the gardens is cross between the Tall and Dwarf variety. So mostly these varieties are dwarf, the height is low, but still they bear fruit and very early, hardly from the third to fourth year. So we can easily collect fruit and use them. It is very easy, and that's why this variety is becoming much popular nowadays, the Tall and Dwarf, the cross between the Tall and Dwarf variety. Mythologically, the coconut tree is known as tree of heaven. Again, there is a very story related to this tree of heaven, and the coconut, again you will find it out in many of these sculptures, in many paintings, the writing records are there in the Vedas, the epics of the Hindu mythology. So in Vedas the coconut is there. So many of these, these are hardly 7 to 8 fruit trees, which are domesticated and cultivated mostly throughout the India. So I think many of other varieties are still there. So I think we will have another webinar for those varieties. Till then, thank you. If you have any questions.
Yes, actually. Thank you so much, Dr. Shreya, for this presentation. We do have a few questions.
Yes.
One is, are Mimosa's elengi fruits edible?
The Mimosa of Silingi, they are normally known as Bakara in Marathi. The common English name for the tree is bullet wood tree. They are not so sweet in taste, like we eat bear or we eat karwanda. But yes, they are edible. Edible by human beings as well as by the birds.
Okay. Another question is, this is a little bit technical question. What is the procedure for natural selection crossbreeding? Some participants have asked some questions privately to me, so that's why you may not see them in that section.
So
I'll repeat the question. What is the procedure for natural selection crossbreeding?
When it was early domestication was there, then people used to select the sweetness or the quality, palatability of the fruit pulp, whatever is present in that. In case of banana, like pulp, if it is not seeded and more sweet in taste, more soft in taste, so then those varieties were selected and the plants were crossed. If the grafting procedure is there, like in case of apple, grafting is easy. So then they were grafted on the wild varieties, and then the plant which was grown after the grafting, those fruits were collected and their seeds were sown for the next yield. Like that, it's a very slow process. To find it out which variety is really good in taste and has more shelf life, it's a very lengthy process.
Okay, this is about the ficus species that you mentioned. How many ficus species you said were edible?
Edible is almost three Spica species, at least I know. I mean, whatever I have studied. Rest of these species, I'm not sure whether they are edible by humans. Almost all these Spica species are edible by birds and animals. But for human beings, one is the carica, that is the anjeer, then guler, those are edible. Because in case of rest of this species, the fruit is very small. The pulp is not there. I mean, the major part which we eat from the fruit is the pulp. And that is hardly there in those fruits. So it may not be palatable for human tongue. And when other things are there already in the forest, why to eat such unpalatable thing?
Actually, guler, she might be wondering what is guler. Guler is the
audumbar tree. Audumbar
tree. That is generally related with Lord Datta.
Umbar, jise kehte hai. Ficus religiosa.
Okay, there is another question. Does all bell trees have thorns?
Yes. That is the main characteristic of Bramnaceae family. Digipus.
Right. All right. There's another little technical question. Can you trace a relationship between calorific value of fruit and domestication?
Not when the domestication started, like the Homo sapiens, which were present in the Bronze Age. They were not much worried about the calorific value of the fruit. That time, the taste was the major factor to select the fruit. And whether it is poisonous or non-poisonous, that was the main factor for the selection of the fruits. The calorific value, yes, in modern days, if the research is carried on, then the calorific value is considered. The domestication purpose was only to have good food to eat, and that's why the taste was this played a major role for the domestication.
Okay, there is one last question. Can you give example of cultivated fruit in which some wild traits can be still seen?
We can say again in case of Zizipus species, sometimes this Zizipus species, they have some fibrous material. If you eat, even in apple bear, agar aap usko khate hai, sometimes that fibrous material khate. So that is the wild trait of the fruit. Even in case of anjeer bee, sometimes some parts are hard. They are not as soft as the other pulp. So wild traits, sometimes they are there. In case of banana, you will not find them, because in case of banana, seed was a major wild trait. And nowadays, all the species of banana are seedless. So that trait is completely removed with the help of with the help of biotechnology and even with the help of natural selection of the fruits.
Okay. Another question is, are there any chances of crossbreeding between wild species and hybrid species?
Yes, so yes.
Okay. And whether this could be a threat to the wild species?
Yes, it could be. But again, I will say not during those period of era. I mean, not during the Bronze Age or the further era. In case of modern human being era, today's Homo sapiens era, it could be a threat to the wild varieties, because then cultivation is increasing a lot. Because of the population demand, or maybe because of the nature of the today's human being, cultivation is increasing a lot. Those days during the Bronze Age or during those neonatal period, the humans were cultivating fruits, you know, only for their own purpose. They were not much greedy, actually. They never used to throw the extra material out. And, you know, they were not much choosy also, because very less food was available for them. But today the conditions are completely different and cultivation rate is increasing. And that is the main threat for today's forest also, at least in India. So yes, today cultivation may be a threat to the original wild species. Like in case of apple, very few apple trees are present in wild areas.
Right. Okay, that's what we see when we go to Himachal and all those places.
Yes.
We see orchards, but we hardly come, or at least I haven't come across any wild variety of apple there.
Yeah, in many cases, right. In many areas, the reserve forest, which is the, you know, next to the protected area of the forest, it is cleared and then domesticated variety of the apples are grown over there. So, अगर वो reserve forest में एकाध wild species होगी भी, तो वो भी निकल जाएगी and domesticated species will be proliferating over there.
Right. Okay. There is another. Okay, this is regarding to the nature camps that we conduct. So, what is the duration between of the nature camp for kids? Okay, I think I can answer that.
Yes.
Nature camp for kids are generally we keep it only for 2 days or maximum 3 days. Not more than that, the residential ones. Otherwise, for students, we have a lot of nature trails that are half-day based, like from Mumbai to Mumbai. We collect them from here in a bus, in a private bus, and then we take them for a nature trail. It's a sort of a half-day program from morning till evening. Yeah? Okay. Another question is... is the wild species of pomegranate from Himachal is edible?
Yes.
And do you have in Mumbai? Okay, sorry. These are the two different questions.
Okay.
So, wild species of Himachal, are they edible?
Yes. All the, from those species only, the palatable species are coming out. So, those species are edible, but the taste will different. See, the taste of the apple bear, which we eat in market in sitting in Mumbai, and the taste of the Ziziphus species, which we eat any forested area, is different. And that actually Ziziphus is a very common fruit all over India. So I think those who have eaten Ziziphus fruits in wild, for them, comparison is very easy. So that the taste of that fruit and the taste of apple bear, which is grown in orchards, it completely different. Similar things will happen with the any wild and domesticated or the cultivated fruit. That taste will be completely different. It will be more acidic. Very first thing, more the acids with there, very less seeds. Agar aap domesticated pomegranate le rahe aur uske suppose aadha kilo ka ek फ्रूट है तो वहां पे हार्डली 30-40 ग्राम का फ्रूट होगा उसमें भी सीड्स कम होंगे एंड द फ्रूट इट विल बी मोर इन द एसिड्स विल बी मोर इन दैट.
ओके ओके. सम पीपल हैव आल्सो आस्क्ड अबाउट, आई थिंक दिस इज रिगार्डिंग अ नेचर कैंप फॉर किड्स. यस, इफ यू हैव वी कैन अपडेट यू ऑन दैट. If you have provided, if you have tick mark yes to the updates in the registration column, you will see, surely receive our updates. Okay, and Dr. Shreya, many of you have thanked you for the presentation. It was a good presentation and a discussion. That was very informative. And thank you very much for spending your time. Actually, the thing is, Oikos is, as you know, you and me are the only two partners in this, and our aim is to take this particular information of scientific, the scientific information in a simple language to the common man. That is what is we are trying to achieve for here.
Right.
I think that we have been successful in all these sessions.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
Our next webinar is going to be on the aquatic research. Okay. And that will be led by Amit Patil, who is actually doing his PhD in aquatic ecology. And that will be conducted on 8th of June at 5 p.m. And I think we have met this Amit during one of our camps, because we try to keep an interaction between researchers and our campers, also between forest department with local people. So we met us during one of our Radhanagri camp, and yes. He was a very enthusiastic boy. He was at the time he was working with SACON, and we found something very interesting for him, because he was working very hard. So we thought that let's give him an opportunity to present his work to and interact with all of you. So do join in us with us for this next webinar, which is on 8th at 5 p.m. And the topic would be aquatic ecology challenges, research, and the faunal biodiversity.
Great.
Yeah. And thank you, Shreya, once again.
Thank you. Thank you to all listeners, actually.
And yes, yes. And all listeners were really very good. They have been asking very good questions. I think right from where we have been starting of the series, we have been getting good questions and good interactions. And today was not the less. You all were really fantastic.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for this. And I'll end the session now. Thank you.